Excellent. So I'm going to read the disclaimer for the show, which is that stock recommendations and comments presented on CPP Chat are solely those of the analysts and experts quoted. They do not represent the opinions of CPP Chat on whether to buy, sell, or hold shares of a particular stock.
Buy so, NVIDIA.
So welcome. Welcome to CPP Chat. We had a discussion earlier about whether this is morning or evening. I think the evening's had it at the time. And,
So you got another guy.
Yes, we have quite the party here. We all of us are returning chatters, and I'm going to allow us each to kind of say what we're doing. Starting with you, Bryce.
Oh, me. I'm Bryce Edelstein-Lalbach. I work at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. I'm the lab's C++ Standards Committee rep. I do a bunch of stuff. My job is mostly developing software, usually parallel programming frameworks to enable scientific applications. And I also do a lot of performance analysis and benchmarking, and then just random C++ stuff.
Okay. And Jonathan.
Yeah, my name is Jonathan Müller. I'm a German computer science student. I've just finished my first semester, so now I have free time for a couple of weeks. And in my, this gives me time to work on my various libraries or blog various things that end up being discussed here a lot of the time.
So you'll have to tell us about why you have the end of your semester in March. That is not what we in America expect at all.
Yeah, it's normal in German. It's nothing special. It's just
it's just John and I being Americans.
Sorry. So our other guest is Odin Holmes. Odin, you want to tell us a little bit about what you're doing?
Yeah, sure. I work at a very small research training and contract development company called AutoIntern. And we do embedded development on microcontrollers and template metaprogramming, which is an odd combination, but it actually works quite well. And I'm also a bridge end developer.
I'm not sure why you say it's an odd combination. I think it's going to take over the world. I think that.
I'm completely convinced of that as well. But you know, walk into some traditional embedded development company and say that, and they will laugh at you.
So go listen to those of you who don't get enough podcasts, and I mean, isn't that all of us? Go listen to embedded.fm. The most recent edition episode had Godbolt on. And talking to the hosts that are clearly C programmers, and they were saying disparaging things about C++, but at the same time kind of envious of some of the things that we can do with metaprogramming. So I think I think it's not a gimme. We'll have to earn it, but I think we're going to take over that space. I mean, by that I mean C++ is going to take over that space. I think there's things we need to do, and I think Odin, you've been one pointing that out. I think it's the, you know, what the compiler offers the embedded developers is pretty attractive.
Yeah. There was a guy on CPP chat, yesterday, I think, it was a C fan. And, he said, you know, one thing he said was, I do wish we had some template stuff in C. And the thing is there, though, like, you can take that same C code, and if you're not doing, like, borderline crazy things like, you know, implicitly casting to void star or something, your C code probably will compile on a C++ compiler. And there's nothing stopping you from not just using all your C stuff and templates, right? I mean, the thing I don't get about all this C++ critique is, you know, almost everything that works in C works one-to-one in C++. You just have other things you can use if you want to. And the counter argument to that is, well, maybe programmers will use too many things. And it's like, okay, you're counting on programmers to be disciplined enough to coordinate, like, resource management and all this crazy stuff. But no, they're not disciplined enough to not use language features they're not supposed to.
That's right. If virtual is in the language, you're going to just have to use it. There's just no choice. This is one of the things that was interesting by listening to the embedded podcast that I was just referring to. I think her name is Elena. I'm not sure what the host's name is. But she said, yeah, we want that. I don't remember exactly what metaprogram or something. She says, but we don't want polymorphism. And it's like, no, what you don't want is runtime polymorphism. You do want polymorphism. You just want compile time polymorphism. You haven't really thought about what polymorphism can do for you. At least that's what I wanted to say back to my podcast, and probably did if anybody was overhearing this on my podcast. So a big event week this week. The biggest news this week was the launch of Visual Studio 2017. In fact, that was the subject of CPP Cast. They clearly changed their schedule, because normally CPP Cast comes out on Friday, but this week it came out on Wednesday in combination with the release of Visual Studio 2017. They had Daniel Moth on, and he spoke about Visual Studio, the 2017 release. I'm excited about it. It's got an awful lot going for it. But
yeah, I'm also excited about it, and I'm a Linux developer.
Go ahead and tell us why you're excited, Bryce.
So this release is the first release that will add CMake support to Visual Studio, and it also adds support for the sort of the directory-based projects where basically, they've added support to Visual Studio for Visual Studio to work with software projects that don't fit the usual Visual Studio build system model of, hey, you've got a solution file. So that's pretty exciting for me, because in combination with their support for cross-compiling and for remote builds, it means that I might be able to use it to build on, you know, one of my Linux clusters at some point in the future, and to build some of the existing software that I have that's, you know, Makefile based or CMake based. So I'm excited because these are all features that I'll start playing with now, hopeful that in the future I might be able to use it for some of my projects.
I think this is one of the things that's the new Microsoft, essentially. You know, when Microsoft felt like they owned the world, the expectation was that everybody had to do everything the Microsoft way. I don't think Microsoft feels like it owns the world anymore. And so Microsoft is willing to be a player. They're willing to support other forms of development. They're willing to support other compilers and things like that. And, mm-hmm. and you know, Microsoft, they have an awful lot to offer. And when they're playing on your team, they're wonderful to have on your team. And so I think this is the new Microsoft. And I think also, you know, it was always kind of, you know, when I do classes, which of course I do, I talk about how good a job both GCC and Clang do of tracking the standard. And it's always been kind of apology, well, you know, and Visual Studio's got a long way to catch up. And I don't think they have a long way to catch up now. They've still got some issues. The biggest one is probably two-phase compilation, but they have committed to having that this year. They said that.
Yeah,
it is going to be here this year, and that is tough. In fact, so much that I know that Bryce has met Charles Ahmed, who I used to work with. Ahmed Charles. he used to work for Visual Studio in tools, and he told me this was after he was no longer there, and we were coworkers at A9. He said, "This is a feature they will never fix. This it is too embedded. It is too deep in the compiler and the way the compiler works. It would just be too expensive to fix." And it was after that, of course, that Microsoft publicly stated, we are going to fix this. We are going to be on the same page as everybody else. I think this is an amazing achievement for Microsoft. And I think they've got a little more work to do, but the rate at which they're catching up means they're going to get there. And so,
yeah, I think I agree. I mean, you know, it's I think what the Visual Studio team is trying to do is be the best IDE solution for all platforms, like that. That's what sort of the change has been more recently. Yeah. That it's not just the best IDE for Windows development. They wanna be the best IDE for C++ programmers in general.
Okay, Odin, you want a chance to give the other side of the story?
Well, yeah, I mean, in that context, I know a lot of, let's say, unnamed template metaprogramming library maintainers and developers who, like, from various sources I've heard a resounding, I hate that compiler with all my heart. And I think it has to do with the handling of aliases, and I must say I haven't played around with this so much in 17, but I know that Boost Metal has had some problems with 17 breaking stuff that worked in 15. And but okay, I mean that, you know, that I had a problem with Compiler Explorer recently and sent Mad Godbolt what I was working on, and his response was, "Oh my God, are you trying to break the compiler?" So I guess it's kind of fair that you know, we're the ones finding the flaws.
Well, sure, Brigand, Hannah, Metal, these are the ones that are going to make the compiler cry, right?
Well, I think if Microsoft were to say we will support Hannah this year, I'd be more surprised.
Well, so I mean, I will admit, I think that there is still lots of work for them to do to catch up with Clang and GCC. But I found the Visual C++ team to be super responsive to bug reports and to the community in general. Like when I was playing around with the release candidate a couple months ago, and I had a problem with the installer, and it was very easy for me to file a bug, and I got, you know, responses from developers pretty quickly, which is actually faster than like my bug reporting pipeline at work. So
well, that's a good sign. Well, you know, depends on which way you look at it. Good, yeah. Sign.
So I think they're really committed to putting out a good modern C++ compiler, and it'll take a little more time, but it's coming.
Yeah, I think the what they have to deal with is legacy, but their hearts and minds are in the right place, and they're part of the community. They're supporting us, and no, I'm absolutely delighted, I'm a little disappointed that we're seeing the breakage that Odin just told us about on Metal, but it's possible that when playing with it a little bit, we can find that there's workarounds, and we can get Metal and Brigand to have a...
Oh, well, I'm sure they'll fix it pretty quickly, because if it worked in 15, then, you know...
People made Boost MPL work on Visual Studio 6. I feel like anything can be done.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, at what compilation speed? But, yeah. Yeah, I mean...
Go look at some point at like old school MPL hacks for like the old Boost type traits. Go look at how things used to be implemented. It is.
Yeah.
It's like find a compiler blog, a bug that you can exploit to implement this metaprogramming hackery.
Whenever I implement something and then put it to CI, it's kind of funny the kind of bugs compilers used to have when I compiled on the older GCC or older MSVC version, and they complain about the funniest things. It's kind of interesting to see what kind of bugs compilers have and what kind of things.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, speaking of Boost metaprogramming, I have a funny anecdote. I met Christophe Henry, the author of Boost MSM, and yeah, I told him that Boost MSM was one of the only pieces of code that I think I will never understand. And he answered, "Well, that's okay, because I don't understand it either anymore."
Okay, that's not scary at all.
Yeah, I often feel that way about parts of my code.
Yeah, that's unsettling when you have that attitude about your own code.
Actually, another anecdote. I wrote a metaprogramming library in Quasier years ago before I joined Bridgen, and I met a kid who said, "Oh yeah, I learned metaprogramming from your library." I'm like, "Oh my God, this guy's a genius. That was not documented."
Yeah.
The secret is you don't leave comments for your users. Just leave comments at least for yourself, so that when you come back to look at it, you can figure out what the heck you did.
Yeah, I'm reminded of a story an engineer once told me about looking at the Apple II assembly language. And of course, this was written by Woz, which was just, you know, this brilliant implementation of how he could get the disk drive controller to work in almost no memory at all. And he was pulling every possible, you know, and he said, you know, this is how I learned 6502 assembly. And I just assumed everybody wrote it that way. And it's like, no, not everybody does that. Anyway, so the other news, which is less newsy, but probably even more important to us all, is what happened at Kona.
Yeah.
And we're going to let Bryce tell us about this because Bryce was actually there. And then when Bryce is finished, we'll embellish this with rumors and gossip. How about that?
Well, the most important thing that happened at Kona is that I got super sunburned last Sunday, and I've been miserable all week.
Right.
Well, so there were really two important things that happened at Kona in terms of like committee deliverables. So the first is that we have sent the draft international standard for C++ 17 out for publication. So ISO is being an international standards organization. There are many flowcharts and stages which a document goes through before it becomes published. So previously, we had sent out a committee draft. We had asked national bodies to provide feedback on that committee draft in the form of national body comments and via a ballot. And at that point, when we ship out the committee draft, the standard is feature complete. So we've known what all the major features of 17 were going to be up until this point. And then after the committee draft, basically the only changes we make are really bug fixes, sort of tweaks to improve the quality of things. Often we'll go through all these national body comments and we'll have a lot of fixes based on those national body comments on bugs that they identified. So you can sort of think of the committee draft like a beta release that we send out to all of these national standards bodies, and they provide bug reports. So we've done that process, and now we've sent out this draft international standard. And so this goes back to the national bodies, and we sort of just vote on whether we're all on board with sending this out as a standard. And if the vote is unanimous, then it's done, and then it gets published. And if it's not, which is I don't believe it's ever happened for the C++ standard, but if it's not, then we would go to an FDIS, or at least it hasn't happened under the current procedure. But so basically, if the first vote fails, then we would go to another vote, which is just a straight up-down vote, and there's a whole bunch of other stuff. But the reality is that it's very likely that in a couple months, before the Toronto meeting in June, in July, all the national bodies will vote yes, and we'll have the standard published. So there probably won't be any more changes. It's probably the document we've sent out is likely to be what's going to get published, module, some editorial changes. So that's pretty exciting. I had a very hectic week. There were six papers. Well, we started the week with five papers of fixes for the parallel algorithms. All of which I had my hand in some fashion, and I shepherded most of them along with Alistair Meredith from Bloomberg through. So it was a lot of work, but I think we were able to get a lot of important fixes in for this new feature. So I was very happy about that. I was very relieved sort of once everything was done on Friday and I could sleep. And we had a whole bunch of fixes for the file system and for deduction guides. There was a lot of work on figuring out how deduction guides needed to be used in the standard library.
You got to tell us what deduction guides are. Give us the short version of deduction guides.
It's a new Turing complete feature of C++.
we have confirmed that. So deduction guides are a way to clarify how template arguments get deduced. It's a new syntax. There's an explicit version where you can explicitly say here's okay, this guide.
Well, okay, hang on. Let's back up a little bit. All right. So in classic C++ and even in modern C++ up to 17, the only time templates could ever deduce types was with functions.
Right.
Now we're saying we're going to deduce template types in structs by actually using the constructor as the function that we're going to deduce from.
Yes, yes. So the feature makes a lot more sense once you're familiar with the class template argument deduction. So basically, now you can just write in C++ 17 pair p and, you know, like int, for example, where you don't need to explicitly say what the template template parameters are for pair, that they can be deduced just like they would be for a function. And deduction guides help you sort of clarify how the deduction happens. There were a bunch of complications with it that when the feature went in, there had not been a library integration paper. And so a lot of the work at the Kona meeting was to make sure that we were using these deduction guides in all the places we needed to in the standard library. So basically, if we had not gotten those changes in, what might have happened is that you would have had weird code that would have compiled but done things that you didn't want it to, or weird code that would have gotten farther along in compilation than you would have wanted it to. But hopefully, we fixed all those issues. And then the other thing that we did at the Kona meeting is we sent the coroutines technical spec to PTDS, which is the equivalent of like a committee draft for international standards. So we sent the coroutines TS out as a draft technical spec, and we'll get NB comments back on it. So I'm pretty excited about this. I've actually been I started working on a new project this week of writing a library that uses coroutines very heavily. So it's sort of got three components. It's got generators. It's got a bunch of different awaitable types. So awaitable types are things that you can wait on with coroutines. So I have a bunch of different sort of trivial ones, and then I have some higher order ones. And then the component that I'm most excited about is these lazy algorithms that I'm working on. So it's kind of tricky to describe, but if you imagine instead of find first of, having like a lazy find next, where it returns you some generator object, which can be iterated, and each iterator is the find first of, and then for like find the first thing, then find the second thing, and find the third thing, or like a for each where suspends on every call to one of the input function objects. So I don't have use cases for most of the things that I'm working on. I've just started playing around with it because I was using coroutines on another project and realized that I could do some pretty cool stuff with it. I'll probably have more to say about that in the coming weeks. I might do some blog posts or something. But I'm very excited about the feature. I think that the cool thing about coroutines is not what we can do with it for asynchrony. That's all very cool, but it's actually a very powerful language feature for transforming your code, even if you don't care about asynchrony or parallelism. I think there's a lot of cool things you can do with it. And so that's sort of why I started working on this library.
So I got to tell you, the first time I saw a talk, and it was Sumant talking about this at ACCU here in the Bay Area, and he started explaining what coroutines were and gave some examples. And I looked at that and said, you can do that? I mean, it's totally mind-boggling, because I think of things from a library point of view. And you absolutely could not implement coroutines in a library. This is compiler magic. And the comment was, this is what the compiler does. It writes code, right? That's what it does. It generates code. In this case, what it's actually doing is it's generating code to be called in the future. And it seems so weird to do it that way, but it allows you to write code. I mean, you have to see it to understand it. And I can't do it justice, but I can say that it really is a really cool feature. And I can see it making code that otherwise would be really hard to understand and really hard to write a lot more tractable. Because you'll just write it in a way that's like, oh, and by the way, there's this await here and this await here, which basically means that this happens efficiently at exactly the right time instead of blocking. But logically, it's as if you were to block and then take over when it's available.
Yeah. I mean, it also has some very cool uses for if you want to write some algorithm, if you want to write an algorithm that's resilient to errors, by which I mean that if you want to write something where, like, if an exception's thrown in the middle of it, you can then have a way to easily go and resume it later after you've dealt with the exception. Like, I've got some algorithm, the user's provided a function object, and it throws an exception, and I want to give the user the capability to handle that exception and then to go and resume execution of that algorithm from the place where the exception was thrown. So there's a lot of cool use cases like that. So most of this is the brainchild of Gore Nishanov from Microsoft. Wow, I guess this is a very yay Microsoft talk. But, the most exciting thing to me about coroutines is if you look at all of the coroutine specific optimizations that Gore has developed. So coroutines, sort of on paper, is this feature that has type erasure and that, you know, might mean to allocate memory. But Gore's figured out all these ways to do devirtualization of the type erasure and to optimize away the heap allocations in a lot of cases. So I've found with the implementation in Clang and LLVM that for a lot of the uses that I care about, there it's zero cost, just gets completely optimized away to just be just a code transformation. So the really exciting thing for me is I've been working for the past year and a half on multidimensional arrays in C++, and one of the tough problems there is how to write a multidimensional array iterator that is usable in a loop that you want to vectorize without inhibiting vectorization. This is often hard because a multidimensional array iterator abstracts away a for loop into the iterator. So like if you go and look at a multidimensional iterator, you'll see like all the components of the for loop, but like there's some of them are in the increment operator, some of them are in other places. The compiler doesn't like see that as a loop. And the way that loop vectorizers work is they're like, hey, I see a loop that's in like this canonical loop form that my compiler has, and I know what to do with things in that form. But then it sees like one of these iterators and it's like, this is just a back edge on this stack. I don't know what to do with this. Like, quit and go home. But I found that using generators to generate indices, so just like a nested for loop that has a yield in the innermost loop, that preserves the loop structure in the LLVM backend so that I can write a multidimensional iterator that vectorizes just fine for my software. So I'm pretty excited about that. That's the use case that sort of got me started down this path.
Very cool. Very, very cool. So I think we talked about the two big things out of Kona. Anything else we want to know about Kona, or just business as usual, cranking out cool new stuff for us in the future?
I think it was also exciting because this was the meeting where we first really started talking about C++ 20, but I don't know that there's too much interesting to say about that yet.
Oh, wait a minute. There's going to be a 20?
Yeah.
We're not just going to stop?
No. So I think 20 will... It's going to be an interesting release. We've had a lot of technical specs in flight right now. And there's a chance if things go well that we'll end up getting a pretty decent sized feature set for 20. I don't know what that's going to look like yet, and I'm hesitant for the committee to indicate what we think might go in.
The chat room wants to know about modules. Vittorio wants to know about abbreviated lambdas.
So I'm hesitant to give a plan, and the reason for that is because I believe that if we indicate a plan, it's hard for the community to distinguish between a plan and a promise, and I don't want us to make promises that we can't keep.
Just give a status. Tell us what happened with modules.
So there was work on the modules TS at this meeting. There was some discussion about whether we should send the modules TS out as a PTDS. So just like coroutine is to send it out in the first stage of publishing it as a TS, send it out for review by national bodies. We decided to hold off on that at the moment, but I think we'll advance work further on modules the next meeting. Go ahead.
What's the status of module macro export problem discussion?
This is excellent.
I believe that currently the plan is that for the first version of the modules TS, that will not be a feature. It is certainly on a lot of people's wish lists. I'll note that I did a count of the Boost libraries. 120 out of 143 Boost libraries export macros in their interface, in some documented things in their interface, not something that's inherited from other libraries in some way. So I think it would be very hard to modularize something like Boost without the ability to export macros.
Wait a minute. Not exporting macros as part of the module doesn't mean that you can't have macros. It just means that that part is not part of the module feature. You still pound include that.
I understand that, but
there's no benefit to it.
I'm not suggesting that it wouldn't work. I'm just suggesting that it would be a large effort, a much larger effort than if we could export macros. So I think modules and concepts will hopefully get some progress made in them at the next meeting, because we won't have anything really to do for C++ 17. It's out the door, barring craziness. There shouldn't be anything more we have to do there. So next meeting we should really be able to dig in and make progress on these on modules and concepts, which are sort of the two big ones that we're starting to get implementations now and that have a ton of stakeholders.
And we have no reason to believe that national bodies aren't going to like 17. I mean, essentially, the national bodies are the people who send representatives to the committee. If there was a great unhappiness with 17, we would know about it.
I mean, again, there is this possibility that the DIS, the draft international standard, doesn't get unanimous yeses, and then we have to go to the final DIS process. But since we've changed to the new process a few years ago, I don't believe it's ever happened. I think set 14 was shipped under the new process. It's very unlikely. It's not something that is a sure thing, but and we won't know until everybody votes. But I think it's very unlikely that we get anything other than a unanimous yes on 17.
Okay, great. So one of the things that's happened this week is that we have a new video series, podcast series. Jens is doing Meeting C++ Live, and they had their first episode this week with Rainer Grimm, who has written a lot of stuff. He has his website, his blog, has an awful lot of information, very future-looking, talking about a lot of multi-process kind of stuff, and this is a lot of good information on it. And so they basically, he, Jens and Rainer had a conversation talking about what his blog was about. So it's a little bit different format than what we're doing. It's closer in format to CppCast, but it's nice to have some alternatives. And one of the things I wanted to have any of you watched that video?
No.
All right. Well, I would recommend it, particularly if you're interested in knowing what's coming up for concurrency. They talk about things like latches and barriers and things like that. I will say that I was a little wondering about some of the source code, but he refers to the proposal. And if you look at the proposal, it's like, that's got to be... there's this one, it looks like an R value reference, but it's not initialized. And I don't think 17 is introducing references that don't have to be initialized. So I'm pretty sure that has to be a mistake in the code. And I'm not really even sure what it's supposed to be doing, but I don't fully understand what the code does either. So I can't really call it out. But anyway, but that was not, I should point out, not Reiner's problem. But he said, you know, this code came from the original paper, and that's why I looked at the paper. I was like, this makes no sense, at least to me. There were several things about the barriers example that I was like, I couldn't think of a better example than this one that actually made sense. Anyway, it's a great talk. And so I recommend, particularly if you're interested in the future of concurrency in C++, to check that out and start reading his blog. And I'm curious to know what the direction that Jens is going to go with this, with the video series. He has a playlist set up with, because it's on the Meeting C++ channel. And of course that has all the videos for the conferences. So it's easy to miss this. There's a particular playlist for, he's calling it Meeting C++ Live. And this brings up a related issue. I had a question in the chat room about should there be an audio version of this podcast, because we don't show with, and one of the things I would point out that Jens is showing, his whatever software he's using to create the video link, he is showing code. He's showing his the actual blog posts and showing code, and we don't do that. And largely the reason we don't do that is because it would be work, and I'm pretty much not excited about doing any of this work. Unfortunately, turning this video podcast into an audio podcast also is work, and so that's why I wasn't too excited about it. But I'm very sympathetic to it, because I know personally I like to listen to a lot of podcasts. My collection of podcasts is really long, and so I can understand why someone would want to turn this into a podcast, because as beautiful as you guys all are, I think that someone could get most of the podcast without actually seeing our faces. so that's something I've been thinking about, and would be interested in knowing what whether anybody is interested in seeing this as an audio podcast or not. And I'd have to figure out how to do that. I've been looking into it a little bit. It doesn't look like it would be impossible to do. However, if we continue to have problems with Google Hangouts, then we may have to stop doing the video podcast. Because I'm still not sure what failed this morning and why we got a late start, but that's what happened. Anybody have any comments to that, thoughts about that?
Well, I had a little bit branching comment about Reiner Grimm for the, you know, three other German listeners that aren't Jonathan. he does some really good German language books for sort of beginner intermediate people. And, you know, most of the books that aren't translated from English into German are like authors that are authors as a job and not C++ guys. And so the books are just terrible. But if you want a good German language book, Reiner Grimm's the guy.
Yeah, I must say, Reiner's book actually taught me C++ 11 and Ray, and it's just
his book. I think it's out in English now, really, isn't it?
It was going to be
in English at some point, but I don't know that it actually... But if it is in English, it's a very good sort of introductory to like the STL. Like, you know, people usually, like as an author, they'll... you know, as an author trying to sell books and not spend a lot of time writing books, which is probably goes for most authors, they have a bias to select, you know, pick and choose from the standard library things that are easy to explain. Whereas I think Reiner, his bias was things that are actually useful, which is a very different set of things to talk about, because you can't talk about everything in the STL in a book. So you have to be filtering, right? So I think his filter is really good, which is what I liked about the book.
So I remember given an opportunity to do a technical edit on a book, and the book was originally written in German, and this was the English translation of it. And interestingly enough, I'm not going to mention the author, but the author, you might be able to guess, has written great stuff in English. He's published English books, but he's a native German speaker. And so he had written this originally in German, and I don't think he had done the translation. I think they just hired someone else to do the translation. And it actually took me a while to figure out that uniformly, every time he meant to use structure, he'd said array, and every time he meant to say array, he'd said structure. But that, of course, was just confusing as heck until I figured that out. And then the rest of it was just, I just kind of politely told the publishing company, I said, I don't think you want to go forward with this. It's just too far gone. And I will say, you know, I've seen material before, particularly from German, I guess maybe really only from German, where in reading the English, you could kind of see it just didn't sound like native English. And yeah, so translating stuff, technical stuff is really hard. I guess translating stuff in general is hard. I mean, I don't know any of the language, so I have to, I'm always amazed at anyone who fluently speaks two languages. That just completely blows my mind. And it's hard for me to think about what that would mean to try to translate and things like that, and try to capture the nuance of what someone explains. You know, if someone's explaining something really well, if there's really good text explaining something, then that means that they've chosen their words carefully and they're thinking about the nuances and things like that. And to try to make that work in another language, it's got to be really, really challenging to do. But I can only appreciate the challenge of someone trying to learn C++, particularly really advanced concepts in C++, where English is not their native language, and almost everything is written in about C++ is in English, or is going to be translated from English. And so even if it's not in English, it's going to be hard for someone where that's not their native language. But I understand there's some good stuff in German. I also understand there's some good stuff in Russian, where Russians are less, you know, the thing about most Germans, the Germans that I've run into are all very, very well educated in English. And so it's not a challenge for them to be able to read technical stuff in English. But I don't think English is taught in Russia the same way English is taught in Germany. And so I think it's a bigger challenge for Russians. So it's more likely that you're going to see English language. I'm also very pleased, I think we can announce this now because we've accepted it, but we have the author of a Chinese book, a Chinese modern C++ book written in Chinese, is going to be speaking at C++ now and talking about a library that he's worked on. So I'm really excited about having him come and meeting him. So I, you know, as an English speaker, I'm in this wonderful situation where, you know, the best C++ stuff is written in English, but I really understand and sympathize people. If English is not your first language and you want to be a C++ programmer, it's hard enough.
Yeah, I'm very excited about that as well, John. I think Chinese programmers are very underrepresented in the C++ community and the standards committee today.
Right.
And it's certainly that there's, from the statistics we have, we believe there's a lot of C++ programmers in China.
Yeah.
It'll be great if we can get more involvement from the international C++ community.
Right. And my guess is that there's probably less understanding of English in China than there is in Russia. And so it's really got to be tough. If English isn't your first language, then how are you going to make sense of things like for and while and static and all these kinds of things, where people who speak English don't necessarily understand what those are supposed to be, right? What a challenge. And then we have function names, more and more algorithms, where essentially if that's not your language, you just have to, you know, you just have to memorize, you know, what does accumulate mean? Or, you know, I mean, that's not your language.
That is not a topic you want to broach with me, but
I knew that was a hot button. That's why I said
But you know, it's interesting too, you know, the standard itself is written in this normative English. And I would imagine that if you are not a native English speaker, it is probably pretty hard. It's probably a barrier to entry to get involved in the standards process when you need to write this very precise language to get a proposal through. You know, where like the placement of a particular comma can be a matter of discussion for lengthy periods of time. So it's in a way, it's like you need to learn English and then you have to learn this other weird, like standard language, to get involved in the standards process.
Very challenging. So anybody else want to talk about things that they've, been playing with? I'm not sure exactly when we started. I try to do about an hour. Since I don't know exactly when we started, I'm not really sure how long we can go.
I think we have 10 minutes left or something like that.
Excellent. Glad you know that. Okay, so we'll try to wind it up in 10 minutes. Did you want to talk about your challenges with trying to get EnableLift to work with your...
I had some pretty standard code that says if you can call this function, then you call this function, else you do nothing. And it uses Affine to do the if you can call this stuff, pretty regular template stuff. But then I compiled my library with the GCC conversion warning and with warnings treated as errors. And suddenly I had a potential call to a function taking an int with a float parameter, which triggered the conversion warning. So I got a warning, and the warning was treated as an error, but Affine can't catch that because Affine doesn't look at warnings. So I have, it basically doesn't work in this case, it still breaks my build, which is kind of annoying.
Right, so we decided that that's Fanoa, right? where substitution failure is not a warning, right? Actually, there was a blog post this week on the Red Hat blog that I thought was kind of interesting, and it was about GCC implicit fall through, and they were talking about. Of course, this is a warning thing. This is not obviously a correctness thing, so it's not an error. But they would give you a warning if you're falling through. And of course, in C++ 17, we now have the attribute fall through, where you can say, this case falls through. And all it does is essentially suppress the warning from the compiler saying, we understand this falls through. But the clever thing that the compiler implementer did is he was actually looking at comments. Because if you'd written a comment that said, this falls through, because if you're writing code that's not yet 17, you can't use the attribute, right? So so the idea was that they're actually looking at the comment, and they've got a bunch of regular expressions to apply to the comment to try to figure out if you're actually making it clear that this falls through. And if you say fall through in a comment, then it won't give you the warning. But if you don't say fall through in the comment, then it gives you the warning.
All I'm going to say, like I read that article, all I'm going to say about that is that if we go down this route, 20 years from now, people are going to be doing metaprogramming in comments.
I must really say, I love how much effort they put into their comment matching code and the regular expressions, and you can select warnings, and you can have all these weird variations on how to spell fall through and caps lock, and just I love how much effort they put into that.
Yes, but it's still so English centric. Why weren't they looking for Russian comments about how to spell fall through in Russian, right?
Maybe because of Unicode issues.
Well, I think the norm in most code that is that most code is written in English. I know here in Germany, even, you know, companies that don't ever expect to, you know, go international or anything, they might hire somebody, you know, from another, like they might hire somebody from Poland or the Netherlands or whatever. And there, you know, the common language is going to be English. And so people should still understand the code. So even, you know, two Germans in a basement coding something will write code in English. Yeah. And it's probably somewhat the same in Russia, I'd imagine.
But well, I mean, you will, well, that's true. A lot of compilers can accept Unicode in the source. You often like a lot of Boost libraries, the copyright and author notice will have some Unicode in it, because there will be non ASCII characters in the author's name.
Oh yeah.
So it's an option. People like JF Bastian would probably use Unicode to do abusive things. I've seen assembly with symbols that have the Unicode unicorn symbol in it.
but Odin, I think you're absolutely right that someone in Germany and working with someone in Poland is very likely. But imagine a situation where you have two Russian programmers who really don't speak English at all, or Chinese programmers that don't speak English at all.
I think
there's probably
it's going to be more common than in Europe, because
people
that speak other languages are farther away, both physically and politically, in both of those countries. But actually, I can tie this back into Microsoft. because there was a really cool, back when I was working with Visual Studios to do like a Windows DLL thing years ago, I found a feature where you could issue a warning if you didn't handle all the cases of a strongly classed enum in a switch, right? And, you know, that's actually pretty cool if you're, you know, because if you add a case to the enum, it'll automatically, you know, break your code, your build, and say, oh, here you're not handling, here you're not handling, here you're not handling, which is great, right? Because I'd rather my build break than my code break, right? And I actually filed a request to Microsoft to have a fall through, basically this, and well, GCC has it now. Hi, Microsoft. I mean, I would certainly use this feature.
If you're using
to C++17 and C++11 and it has to work on Clang too, so you know maybe you can't use this.
Well, if you're using modern code, then just use the fall through attribute, right? I mean, this was specifically designed as a hack for older code. Modern code doesn't need this because that's kind of why it was put in. It was kind of like, when they implemented the code for 17, it was like, how could we backport this in some kind of useful way and leverage what we've done? And actually, it was very clever. If you read the blog post, you'll find out all sorts of things, the things they did even before they resorted to looking at comments. In other words, if the fall through would immediately hit essentially a return or something like that, then they assumed that, well, that's probably safe. It probably isn't. You know. So if you immediately did something after the fall through, then it considered that was probably likely intentional and stuff like that. So it was very well thought out. I thought very clever. The whole scary thing about it was, should the compiler ever be reading our comments and try to make sense of them, which is
no.
Yeah, no.
I mean, if the compiler should read comments, then the comments must be in a specific format and part of the grammar, and then we basically have attributes.
Then we'll need comments.
At best, it can be a heuristic. No, I think they did it appropriately, right? It's only for warnings.
Yeah.
It would really be scary if it was actually trying to read your code in order to figure out how to generate code, or read your comments in order to figure out how to generate code. It's like, that's pretty...
You know, speaking of diagnostics, one of the things that I like about Visual Studio and also about the Intel compiler that I wish I had in Clang and GCC is warning diagnostic numbers. So in Visual Studio and Intel, like for all my projects, we have a list of, you know, these diagnostic numbers, you know, like they're all usually four digit numbers, need to be disabled. And I find that they're generally more fine grained than the flags that I get from Clang and GCC. And it's just, it's like, it's easier for me to figure out what thing to turn off. And also like the diagnostics from Clang and GCC, the names are often not consistent, and some of them tend to be a lot coarser than I want them to be. It's a feature I would really like. So somebody go rewrite Clang's diagnostics to be finer grained and to have diagnostic numbers for everything.
Well, the diagnostic numbers are so that you can turn them off, right? So right. If you have code where, yes, I understand why there's a warning. This is potentially dangerous, but I'm aware of that. I've thought it through, and I've decided that it's not dangerous, which is why it's not an error. It's just a warning. And you want to be able to turn that off because other people are going to compile your code, and you don't want to throw that warning. So you turn it off. And that's nice to have that ability.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, what I also like about MSVC is that they have a lot of useful warnings enabled by default. For example, the conversion warning is enabled in Visual Studio by default, whereas in GCC, it isn't included in the all warning set. It isn't included in the extra warning set. You have to look up this flag and add it separately. It's just...
That's because you have to condition your... Like, Visual Studio users were conditioned for that. Like, you can't you can't just turn that on, like, without, like, a revolt for GCC or Clang. But yeah, no, I agree with that. I think that in general, most of the times when I forget to turn on additional warnings with a compiler, I usually end up shooting myself in the foot and finding out a couple weeks later.
Well, that sounds like a tip for safe coding, so it may be time to wrap that up and wish everybody safe coding. Before that, I want to apologize for people for the technical difficulties, the late start, and all the other issues. Thank Bryce for coming to the rescue. Technically, I'm not sure exactly what he did, but he made it happen. So we'll have to figure out how to move the video from Bryce's channel into the CPP chat channel. And then again, if we get the right feedback, maybe we'll go ahead and start trying to figure out how to make this an audio channel as well.
John, we didn't say anything about C++ now.
And I did not make it.
I should.
Yes. Wait a minute. Wrong conference.
Yeah.
let's see. Which side? Okay.
I wonder if we get fired for that.
C++ now update. I'm hoping to hear an update about student volunteers. Do we have an update on that?
Nope, not yet. If you're a student and you want to come to C++ now, go to the website. There is a page there where you can send in an application.
Jonathan wants no one else to apply, I think is what he's saying.
I think I know two other students that want no one else to apply.
it is a competitive program, but...
It's very competitive. The applications every year are, the essays are just really good. And I'm always embarrassed to think about, oh, we have these people who are, you know, PhD candidates using C++ for robotics, and we're paying them to hold up a sign. Well, not even paying them. Right? We're, you know, screening them to hold up a sign that says, please repeat the question. They might be slightly overqualified for some of the work we're having them do. But it's a great program. So absolutely, you know someone who you think would get something out of the program, then please come. And of course, if you're not a student yourself, then please register and join us, because everybody's going to get something. Anybody's interested in C++.
This year's program is going to be awesome. We'll probably have an announcement about the first keynote up next week. And there's a theme to the keynotes this year that I'm pretty excited about. It's not a year to miss. I think it's going to be a really great conference this year. I'm very excited about it.
We are not yet sold out, but I think we're about 20 to 30 away from selling out. The reason I don't know is because we haven't registered the speakers themselves. We are limited, for those of you who don't know. The conference itself is limited. We can only have about 140 to 150 people there, And that includes speakers, that includes everyone. And so we, in order to know what the limit is, we have to know actually how many speakers. And we don't accept speakers based on the number of speakers. We accept speakers based on the time of their sessions. So if you have some multi-speaker sessions, then you end up with more speakers. And if you have speakers presenting multi-session talks, then you have fewer speakers. Or if you have speakers that have two separate talks, whatever. So the point is, we don't know exactly how many speakers we have, but we have to subtract that from the basically 140 that we're allowed to have, and then we back out and figure out how many people we have. So we have, at this point, about 80 registrations, and I think we could probably go to about 110, because I think we'll probably have 30 to 40 speakers. I haven't actually counted them myself. Yeah, we're not sold out, but we're getting there. And so I think it's going to be a great conference. Bryce, I think rightly, is not announcing the theme for the keynotes, but I know frequent appearant on this show, Michael Case. Michael hates keynotes. He wishes we didn't have keynotes at all. But when I told him what the theme was for the keynotes, he was kind of excited about it. He says, oh, that sounds pretty good. So I think you want to be there in person. It's going to be a great conference, and encourage everybody to register.
Yeah.
I was very impressed with your lineup of speakers. I was looking through them again the other day, and I'm also very glad that you're going to have video, because otherwise there's no way I'd be able to, like, I don't know how you're going to do the tracks, but there's no way that I would be able to see all the stuff I want to see at the conference.
Well, one thing I would say is, if you're a speaker and you want to know what the, we have a candidate schedule. It is not made public yet, but if you're a speaker and you want to know what it looks like you'll be speaking, just let me know and I'll give you a link to the schedule. And then we'll probably have that published in about a week, I think.
Yeah.
Is when the deadline is to have that public.
John, have we announced yet about the video recording for this year?
It hasn't been formally announced, but I've teased it on the on the chat groups, and we announced it. I said it here, and that is that Bash Films is going to be recording the sessions. And those of you
that's the same company that does CPPCon.
Right. If you've seen any of CPPCon's sessions and you enjoyed those, then that's the quality we'll be able to expect. And I want to say up front, that is not a reason to not attend. It sounds like a reason to not attend because you're going to have great videos, but that is not a reason to not attend.
Yeah, I would certainly, if you're on the fence, I would register before we start announcing keynotes, because we will sell out once that happens.
I think that's very true. We're going
to. Plus, you guys have a ratio of 2-1, basically, speakers to guests.
Yeah.
Which means being able to talk to these people.
That's right.
I mean, that's something I really enjoy at conferences. Like, that's why you go, to talk to these people, because. That's right. You know, most of the time you can't pay for that level of expertise. I don't care who you are, right? Okay. Like consulting or otherwise.
If you're interested in, as Odin knows, Brigand, we're going to have the authors of Brigand, including Odin, will be there. And if you want to talk to them about something, well, I'll just put it to you. Odin, would you be willing to sit down and talk to somebody if they're willing to buy you a beer?
Oh, sure. Give me your 5 megabyte template error, and I'll tell you exactly why.
reminds me of Spirit in the old days, when you would get 10,000 line error messages that two people could parse in the planet.
Actually, my latest error was 10 megabytes, but because I was working on a type that actually was 10 megabytes in size, and TFP can actually do things that large scale now. Like it was a 10,000 element list, and then the name of 10,000 elements turned out to be that size. so it was the printf debugging of making an error that was that size.
Speaking of metaprogramming, I think I forgot the actual most important thing from the Kona meeting, which is that the reflection study group has been extended to be the reflection and metaprogramming study group, because we figured out that that it was kind of hard to do write a static reflection feature for the language without having a metaprogramming facility to use that static reflection feature with.
Makes sense.
So we now have a metaprogramming study group that's chaired by Chandler Carruth of Google and LLVM fame.
Okay, so I think we've overstayed our welcome.
So I think really so.
Anyway, please join me in wishing everybody safe coding.
Safe coding.
Safe coding.
Safe coding.